Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to worship on this beautiful Indiana day anyway. And happy Mother's Day to those of you who are celebrating. I can tell it's Mother's Day because there's lots of older kids in church for change. But I have learned, and I have learned over the years, that Mother's Day is as hard as it is holy for a lot of people. So we're going to open with a prayer before we proceed with all of the things that we have to celebrate and worship around this morning. So please pray with me. Oh, stand if you want. I wasn't going to make you stand, but you know, if you're feeling pious and all, let us pray. On this Mother's Day, we give thanks for loving, wonderful mothers who've given their children more gifts than they can count. We give thanks for new mothers who boldly, bravely welcome new life into the world, and for those who struggle with that calling. We give thanks for those who choose their children, for adoptive and foster parents who model the adoptive love of God, and for those who have made the hard, holy, and loving choice to entrust a child to the care of others. We give thanks for those who choose to remain without children of their own, sharing love with the world in other ways. And thanks, too, for aunts and godmothers and neighbors and teachers and stepmoms, too, who share the love of a mother with so many. We pray for the many mothers who bear the unimaginable burden of having lost a child in any way. We pray for those who struggle with infertility, whose desire for a child has been met with frustration. We pray for the mothers of children with special needs and chronic illness, who know anxiety and exhaustion in ways others do not. We pray for those who were given abuse and heartbreak by the ones called to love them. We pray for those whose mothers have died, who on this day celebrate and grieve their mother in her absence. And we pray with great thanksgiving for a mothering God who gives us all these gifts, shows us all this love, and invites us all to return it to the world. Amen. Let's continue our worship as we do in the name of God the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And let's sing together hymn 660.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
O God of peace, you brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep. By the blood of your eternal covenant, make us complete in everything good that we may do your will and work among us all that is well-pleasing in your sight. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated.
Good morning. Before I start the readings, when I was still a very young child, we were taught the 23rd Psalm. And like so many of my age now, we learned the King James Version. Today, with Pastor Mark's kind permission, I would like to read that version. For those of you following in the Pew Bibles, the words found on page 435 will not match exactly, but believe me, the same meaning is there. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Thank you for the indulgence. The second reading this morning is from Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 14, and is on page 970 in the Pew Bible. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by a son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds. He is the reflection of all God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being, and he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purifications for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. For to which of the angels did God ever say, "You are my son, today I have begotten you"? Or again, "I will be his father and he will be my son"? And again, when he brings the firstborn into the world, he says, "Let all God's angels worship him." Of the angels, he says, "He makes his angels winds and his servants flames of fire." But of the Son, he says, "Your throne, O God, is forever and ever, and the righteous scepter is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. And in the beginning, Lord, you founded the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you remain. They will all wear out like clothing. Like a cloak, you will roll them up, and like clothing, they will be changed. But you are the same, and your years will never end." But to which of the angels has he ever said, "Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for the feet"? Are not all angels spirits in the divine service, sent to serve for the sake of those who are to inherit salvation? Here ends the reading.
Thank you. Can I have the young ones meet me down front for the grab bag, please? For some of our guests and new friends, you should know this is how we do children's sermons, right? We pull a surprise out of this bag. Whoever pulls the surprise out gets to keep it. And we try to find something meaningful to say. Who's going to pull the thing out today? Okay. No one's trying to beat you to the punch. Does someone over there have something to say about this? Did you put this in here?
No.
Oh. Are you happy about it?
No, I have a second one.
You already have one of these?
Yep.
Okay. Maybe you could share it.
Here,
what is it? You want to tell us why you already have one of these?
It's a triceratops that comes in a kit and you put it together. And you put it in your room and then it glows in the dark.
Oh, I was hoping it glowed. Thank God it glows. Triceratops comes in a kit. You put it together, it glows. I'm glad it glows. I was hoping it glowed because we are talking today about grace on fire. That's our theme for the day. And we use that phrase because it comes from that reading that we just heard from the one. I might need a new battery. And we use that phrase because it says that God's servants are like flames of fire. And we want to be like flames of fire because we want to burn brightly through our words and through our actions and through our giving and through our generosity and through our kindness and through our love for the world so that people look to us and look at us and learn from us what God's love looks like, right? So just like your Triceratops model glows in the dark, we want to shine a light into the darkness of the world around us through the ministry that we share here, okay? Now, you take that and put it next to your other one. You've got twins, or share it with him. Beautiful. Let's pray, shall we? Mighty and gracious God, we give you thanks for beautiful, simple examples of what it means to be kind and generous and to share. We give you thanks for the gift of light in the dark, for the blessing it is to be your servants in this world, sharing grace and good news and love the way it has already been shared with each of us. And we ask that you give us courage and faith enough to be faithful in these ways for the sake of the world. In the name of Jesus Christ, crucified and risen for the sake of all that you have made. Amen. Thank you very much. Have a wonderful week. Everyone else, let's stand for the gospel acclamation. The Gospel according to John, the 10th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
At that time, the festival of the dedication took place in Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was walking in the temple in the portico of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered them, "I have told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name testify to me, but you do not believe because you do not belong to my sheep. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. What my Father has given me is greater than all else, and no one can snatch it out of the Father's hand. The Father and I are one." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Maybe you remember, maybe you haven't heard yet, there's a good chance you don't care. But I said last week that I wanted these next handful of Sundays on the other side of Easter to be as practical for us as they are holy when it comes to letting everyone know what we are up to around here as far as the big picture of our ministry goes at Cross of Grace. Our council president, Gail Beebe, has been keeping us all in the loop once a month after each of our council meetings. Hopefully you've noticed that. We'll have our Q&A sessions today after worship and next Sunday between services too, all in preparation for our annual meeting on the 22nd of May. And hopefully you've read and noticed some of these little tidbits in the newsletter that you would have received sometime in the last week or so. But we have learned over the years that you can't say the important things too often, whether we're talking about the good news of the gospel or the business of the church. Everyone is never paying attention all at the same time. And the most convenient time, we've learned, to get most people's attention, their most undivided attention, is during the 15 minutes or so, and not much more than that, of the sermon time on Sunday morning. So I hope you're listening. I hope you're paying attention. I hope you hear me when I say that we have paid off the mortgage on our building this week, and we are effectively debt-free as of Wednesday. We have warned you this was coming. We've hinted that it was getting close. We've been working very deliberately toward this goal for the last few years, and over the course of the last year, really, even more deliberately, and it feels amazing to have made it happen. But what now? And what's next? And where in the world do we go from here? Before we get into all of that, I'd like to connect all of this to today's gospel. I did not go fishing for my own gospel reading today because it seems, again, meaningful that the assigned reading for this morning has us meet up with Jesus in the temple during the festival of its dedication, that holiday when faithful Jews gathered at the temple in Jerusalem to celebrate its rebuilding after it had been destroyed, to celebrate their own national identity as God's chosen ones, and to commit to their own rededication as children of God in the world. There's a lot there for us to wonder about and to learn from. First of all, we know that the whole idea of a permanent temple in a place they could call home, like Jerusalem was for the Jewish people, was a powerful sign of God's presence and God's provision for the people in Jesus' day. Before this, you might remember, back in the days of their exodus and wilderness wandering, God's temple was mobile. It moved around with the Israelites wherever they went as they made their way, living and moving and breathing and struggling and fighting and dying and surviving on their way to the promised land. So for many, many, many generations, God's presence was evident to God's people by way of God's mobility and God's willingness to walk with and to accompany and to travel alongside and to lead and to set up camp in the form of a tabernacle with the people in the wilderness wherever they landed. So when Jesus shows up all those generations later, strolling through the permanent, planted, stationary synagogue of all synagogues, the symbolism is powerful and packed with meaning for me. Yes, the temple is home base, and it's a beautiful place to gather, to celebrate, to worship, to recall the mighty acts and all the kept promises of God. And as Jesus reminds his disciples, the Father and he are one. God and I are one and the same, he tells them. And here I am, walking and talking and living and moving and breathing and marveling myself at all these columns in Solomon's portico. And so it seems to me Jesus is letting them know that things have changed. Something's different now. Things are different with Jesus in the mix. God is on the move again. On the other side of Easter, as we gather to celebrate and to give thanks for all that this place means for us and that it's paid for, I want us to remember and I want us to give thanks for and I want us to celebrate most that God is on the move again. That God is on the move still, really. And that we're being invited to keep up and to keep moving too. And thanks to some prayerful, faithful planning on the part of our church council and our stewardship team, this is how we are proposing we will do that. What has always and only been known as our building fund, what we've always and only used for the sake of building buildings and paying off mortgages, is being transformed into a building and outreach fund from now on, or for the foreseeable future anyway. We will still make separate commitments and pledges to this fund in the fall of every year. It will still help us plan for building expansion and for facility improvement projects, but going forward, 50% of it all, 50% of it all, half of it, will be used for mission and outreach efforts beyond these walls that we have built. Until now, because we've been so aggressive about paying down our mortgage, only 10% of our building fund offerings were leaving our coffers. 10% is not nothing, and it's meant a lot to our friends in Haiti and to our friends up in Noblesville at Roots of Life, but 50% is 50%. And here's what that will look like. 50% of our building and outreach fund will still do work for us here at Cross of Grace. 25% of it will help us save and prepare for our next building and expansion project, whether that's the pavilion we're hoping to get some grant money for, or the addition of square feet in the sanctuary, which might push this wall out in that direction to give us more space in here. The other 25% down at the bottom will be an emergency fund or repair and improvement fund for projects that come up along the way with any facility over time. Think new roof, think blacktopping the parking lot, think replacing tired, old, broken HVAC units, stuff like that. And again, 50%, the blue stuff on the left-hand side, of all of this will be on the move, doing God's work out in the world, which is what we're here for in the first place. And you can see we're keeping Zami Fanwa, our friends in Haiti, and Roots of Life, our friends in Nobleville, in the mix, but we're going to up their gifts from us from 5% to 10%. We're going to add 5% to the Mission Endowment Fund every year just to keep that important investment in ongoing ministry in the forefront of our minds, and remember that that too always and only goes outside of us. And then we still have another 25% of these building and outreach offerings to give away every year, which means we're going to start accepting applications. We will propose grants ourselves, and we'll invite ideas and interests from our community, from all of you. We'll have a small team of Cross of Gracers help make those decisions every year as the money is available. So, if Don Becker's math is correct, and Don Becker's math is always correct, people, this is what we could accomplish for ourselves for the kingdom in just the next year with the building and outreach fund commitments like the ones we made and continue to honor this year. The short of the long is, even if we don't grow, which we will, even if we don't stretch, which we have never stopped doing yet, and even if we just keep plugging away at the rate we've been plugging away this past year, we will be able to take care of plenty of things around here, building expansion project, saving, building repairs and improvements, and we will be able to take care of giving away something like $77,000 as a way of sharing grace with our community and with the world around us. Someone suggested to me not long ago, with equal measures of cynicism and concern, I believe, that once we paid off our mortgage, people weren't going to keep giving. as generously as we've always given in the past. I hope this kind of news changes that for them and for any of you who may have felt that way until now. We've called this year of our building fund, again, Grace on Fire, which is exactly this kind of movement we hope will happen among us. The idea that our generosity and our giving would continue to grow and to expand and to do God's work right here among us in ever-increasing and always faithful ways out there in the world too. On the other side of Easter, God is calling us to be on the move with Jesus, and we are. And I hope you will join us, and God only knows where we are headed next. Amen. Let's stand and sing, please. As you can see, if you're following along in our bulletin this morning, our next order of business and opportunity for worship is to confirm and affirm the faith of our eighth graders. We have with us here Faith Johnson and Sadie Miller. You should also know that we have at second service Lily Buest and Ginny Walters. They're going to affirm their faith at our second service this morning. So we'll keep them in our hearts and in our minds and on our prayers as we walk through this service with Faith and Sadie, but please follow along. Oh, for what it's worth, these two and the other two are eighth graders, which means they have made their way through our three-year faith formation program, which starts in sixth grade, and they learn all kinds of things, we hope, specifically about the promises made on their behalf at their baptism about the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, the Ten Commandments, and what it means to be a part of a family of faith. So we're glad to have them making these commitments and saying these words out loud for themselves. Faith and Sadie, we rejoice that you now desire to make public profession of your faith and assume greater responsibility in the life of our Christian community and its mission in the world. In holy baptism, our Lord Jesus Christ received you and made you members of God's church. In the community of God's people here, you have learned from the Word God's loving purpose for you and for all creation. You've been nourished at the table of Holy Communion, and you've been called to be witnesses to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, therefore, I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, to reject sin, confess the faith of the church, the faith in which we baptize. Do you renounce all the forces of evil, the devil, and all his empty promises?
I do.
Do you believe? Let's say this with them together, shall we? So so we can hear it. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father, Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
I make jokes sometimes, but the real meaning of saying that together for and with them is to stand in solidarity of faith with these young believers as they affirm their faith. And also, whenever I think of the creed, especially at a time like this, I think of something Nadia Boltz-Weber said. She said, none of us believes all the things in the creed all of the time, but when we say it together, we can trust that one of our fellow believers believes something that we might not. And so when we say it all together in community, it is faithful and meaningful and deep and wide. So thanks for playing along. Back to you two. Faith and Sadie, you have made a public profession of your faith. Do you intend to continue in the covenant God made with you in baptism, to live among God's faithful people, to hear God's word and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of our Lord Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth? Let us pray. Gracious Lord, through water and the Spirit, you have made Faith and Sadie your own. You forgive them all their sins and bring them to newness of life. Continue to strengthen them with the Holy Spirit and daily increase in them your gifts of grace, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in faith, oh my gosh, the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience and suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. Amen. Sadie Lou. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Sadie the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience and suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. Amen. Come this way and turn around. You got to look at them for a minute. Please give them a round of applause and welcome and congratulations. You can be free now. Thank you very much. Let us continue with our prayers.
Set free from captivity to sin and death, we pray to the God of resurrection for the church, people in need, and all of creation. Gentle Shepherd, enable your church to respond to the voice of Jesus. Give us unfailing trust, unafraid to join in Jesus' work of renewing all things. God, in your mercy. Feed your people at the table of creation. Prepare a safe place for those whose environments are dangerous or unhealthy, especially those making difficult journeys. Prosper your creation for the sake of everything living. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Warm the hearts of all who celebrate and all who mourn on Mother's Day. Accompany those yearning to be mothers. Help us to heal from broken family relationships and open us to receiving your nurturing love from all who serve mothering roles in our lives. God, in your mercy, seek out those who weep while they await healing or consolation. Set people in their path who provide the care they need and wipe away every tear from their eyes. God, in your mercy, inspire the words of prophets and saints who employ innovative imaginary to stretch our understanding. Send Christ to instruct us with motherly care. God, in your mercy, enfold us in great multitude of saints from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages. Wash us in your saving grace every day, guiding us in your waters of life. God, in your mercy, in your mercy, O God, respond to these prayers and renew us by your life-giving Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. Maybe.
Just a few announcements, short and sweet, I hope. One is another reminder that we'll have a Q&A between worship services this morning and next week to answer more questions and say more things about some of what I shared today, but also what we plan to accomplish at our annual meeting on May 22nd. On May 22nd, this is the thing I hope you noticed already in the newsletter that was a hint about all of this, is we will have one worship service that day at 9:30 outside, hoping for a day like this, so you could start praying now if you want. And we will somehow set fire to something relevant to our mortgage and also be able to do that all together in one place at one time. So please remember that and spread the word that on the 22nd of May at 9:30, we'll have one service outside to take care of our annual meeting and mortgage burning and celebrating and all of that. If you have all of your people with you today, if you got your hair did, Mark Blatchley is going to be here to take pictures to update our directory. There are a lot, the Anderson boys are like infants in the last picture we have of them. Some people didn't even exist the last time they updated their family's picture. Peyton, my gosh, he's like prepubescent and now he's 7 feet tall. So if you're all here, find Mark Blatchley and update your family's picture, please. And lastly, there's cake in the fellowship room in honor of our confirmands. So if nothing else, go there and get some cake. Let us please give and receive our offering. Thank you.
Pray. Most gracious God,
we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who rose beyond the bounds of death and as promised poured out your Holy Spirit of life and power and hope upon all those who belong to you. At this, all of creation celebrates with boundless joy. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Let us pray. Mighty and everlasting God, we give you thanks for good news and great joy for all people. We give you thanks for good news and great joy for those of us who gather around this table now on the other side of Easter. As we gather here, we remember this night long ago when Jesus too gathered with his disciples, when he took bread, broke it, gave it for them to eat and said, "Take this and eat it. This is my body and it's given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And then again after supper, Jesus took a cup. He blessed it and he gave thanks and he gave it for each of them to drink. And he said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. It's shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." So we eat, we drink, we remember, we give thanks. And we ask, Lord, that you use all of this and all of us to be blessings for the world around us by your grace in Jesus' name. And we ask, Lord, too, that you remember us now and always in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated. If you're a guest with us today, please hear and respond to a sincere invitation to join us for the sharing of the meal. All are welcome in this place and at this table, and we hope that you will join us. If you do come forward, you'll receive a piece of bread, and then you'll walk by a tray that has both red wine around the outside of the tray and white grape juice in the center, and you may help yourself to whichever you prefer. If you require or desire a gluten-free wafer, please let me know that, and I can accommodate. Please stand if you are able. Now may the body and the blood of our risen and living Lord Jesus Christ bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor now and always and give you peace in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Alleluia. Let's sing together hymn 720.
Serve the risen and living God. Lord.
Thanks be to God.